getting salvation. Sometimes we do it. Sometimes we make it seem harder than it's supposed to be. Putting it back into context, in Romans 10, Paul starts out by saying, "Brothers and sisters, my heart's desire and prayer to God for the Israelites is that they may be saved." Paul pours out his heart for his own people. He wants his own people. His people are Israel. If you had a heart for your family, for your people to find Jesus, if they would just find Jesus. Paul is sharing his heart for his people. He's also explaining to us God's heart for his people. Israelites were God's people. Now, in the midst of this, we're going to see that salvation is for everyone, but it was first for the Jew. That was the beginning of Romans. It was given first for the Jew, then for the Gentiles. But Paul is brokenhearted because his own people refuse salvation. Paul knows exactly where they are because he was there himself. He knows what it was. What it was like to reject Jesus, because that was just too easy. It's just too easy. You're watching people get saved, and their life's turning around, and they don't have to do anything to earn it. They're just enjoying freedom, just enjoying being forgiven. So that's too easy. You got to work for it. And so he says in verse 3, since they did not know the righteousness of God and sought to establish their own, they did not submit to God's righteousness. God's righteousness. Okay, remember, righteous means right with God, getting right with God. And we know from throughout the Bible that righteousness is how you get to heaven. Righteousness, being right with God, that's who he lets in if you're righteous. Proverbs tells us in the path of righteousness is everlasting life. That's how you go to heaven. You got to be right with God. The people who are in heaven will be the righteous, but not the self-righteous. That's the really important distinction. You don't get to heaven on your own terms. Self-righteousness, grading yourself on your own scale, living up to your own standards, will not get you in the door. It is only God-righteousness that will get you in. And so Paul started off the book of Romans making a thorough case to say that I don't care how self-righteous you are or self-unrighteous you are, nobody is righteous enough for God. You're not going to make it in. But God gave us a simple way. You have to be saved, not earned, saved. It's about salvation. It's about rescue. And so he explains that the Jews, now not all of them, but many of them, sought to establish their own righteousness, and so they refused to submit to God's righteousness. Verse 4, Christ is the culmination of the law so that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. He says it's all about Jesus. Jesus is the one way. Jesus made it right. Jesus lived out the law. He fulfilled. He set everything right so that we could be saved. He died in our place. And I know that sounds like, yeah, I've heard that. That's the Christian message. That's right. But I showed up for church this morning to hear something deeper. Sometimes you got to get back to what's simple. Just the simplicity of being saved. Sometimes we overcomplicate the story. Keep it simple. So he goes on to explain. Here's where we left off at verse 5. He goes on to explain about the simplicity of just being right with God by faith. Verse 5, Moses writes this about the righteousness that is by the law. Now he's going to do some Old Testament quoting. This one's out of Leviticus. He says, okay, talking about the Jews, so this is the text that they respect. Back in Leviticus, the person who does these things will live by them. The person who does these things will live by them. All right, if you want to be righteous by setting yourself a bunch of rules, if you want to be righteous by law and living up to it, then you have to live by it. You have to live by it completely. The person who does these things, and it's about doing. Remember, I told you about the young guy, the rich young ruler who walked up to Jesus and said, well, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life? And his focus was on that word. What do I have to do? He didn't say, what do I have to believe? He wanted to do something. You remember what Jesus told him? It was interesting. Jesus didn't just say, well, you have to believe in Jesus or believe in me. He didn't just say, follow me. He said, well, you know the laws. He brought him back to the law. See, the law had a purpose. It wasn't just God wrote this law and said, well, that didn't work. We're going to go with this Jesus thing. Grace is a whole lot better. Law has a very important purpose. Galatians says that the law is like a schoolmaster. It drives us to realize a need. It makes us recognize we're not good enough. The law is there so that we'll realize that we're not good. We're not righteous. So Jesus said to the young man, he said, you know the rules. And he named off a few of the rules. And he said, well, you know, respect your parents. Don't lie, cheat, and steal, that stuff. He starts listing off some of the first few commandments. Keep the Sabbath. He lists off some of the last of the Sabbaths. Don't murder, don't steal. He lists off the last half of the commandments, which have to do with how you treat others. Well, he was a respectful young man. He was raised well. He said, I've kept all those since I was a little kid. But somewhere in his heart, he knew he still wasn't good enough. And so he's still asking, so what else do I have to do? And Jesus said to him, go and sell all you have, and then come and give it to the poor, and then come follow me. Now, do you think that Jesus was telling this guy that you have to give everything you have in order to be saved? Well, we know from the rest of the Bible, that's not how you get saved. So why does Jesus tell the guy that you have to give it all away? Because Jesus had only mentioned the commandments that he was keeping. Respect your parents, don't murder anybody. But then he gets to the one he had missed. He was a rich kid, and he'd grown up relying on his riches, and his riches became his idol. What's the first commandment? You will have no other gods. It was always about God. It was always about your relationship with God. It was always about connecting with God from the very first of the Ten Commandments, from the very most important of the commandments. Jesus said the most important commandment is love God. That's what it comes down to. But the kid got mixed up in the details and started saying, well, I followed this one, I followed this one, I followed this one. I'm doing. But he missed number one. Love God and no other gods before me. And he got lost, and Jesus said, you got to get that other God out of the way. Now, the answer to the question came at the very end. Jesus said, and then come, after you give it all away, then come follow me. That was the answer. It's just as simple as following Jesus. But sometimes we get things in the way. The person who does these things will live by them. But then in verse 6, he says, but the righteousness that is by faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the deep, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. He says, don't overcomplicate it. Don't make it too deep. Now, he's quoting the Old Testament. At first, he quotes Leviticus. He's quoting Moses both times because the Jews respected Moses. And the first time, he says, all right, if you want to live by the law, you got to live it all. You can't just live a few of them. That's what Jesus did with the young man, right? He gave him a few of them. And he said, oh, yeah, I did that one. I did that one. He said, but you didn't get all of them. In fact, you ignored the most important one. Jesus said the same thing to the Pharisees. He said, you guys tithe on your spices. I mean, you count out your little spices. And you're like, I'm going to give a tenth of my cumin. I'm going to give a tenth of, you know, you count out every little asparagus and say, one of every 10 goes to God. Say, all right, that's cool. You want to live right. But then you neglect justice. You neglect mercy and grace, the big things, the stuff that matters. You don't love people. If you don't love people, you miss the point. If you want to live by the law, you got to live the whole thing, what it's all about. And what did it just say about the law in verse 4? Jesus is the culmination of the law. That's what the law is all about. He fulfills it. If you try to live self-righteous, then righteousness has to be an achievement. You try to earn it. You try to work your way up. And that's what, then he quotes in Deuteronomy 30. This is actually Moses speaking to the Jews just before he died at the end of Deuteronomy. Verse 7, who will descend into the deep? Back in verse 6. The righteousness that is by faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down. All right, this was actually Moses talking to the Israelites. He said, hey, what I'm setting before you is not too difficult for you. You see, the story of salvation by faith goes back to the Old Testament, all the way back to Abraham. He believed God, and God counted it to him as righteousness. And for the Israelites, they were not just given an impossible task. Moses delivered to them, he said, what Moses gave to them, he gave them the law, but they were given more than law. You recognize that? It wasn't that God just gave them an impossible task. They were given the law, but along with the law, they were given the sacrifices. You read the Leviticus, and you read all these pages of how to sacrifice animals. You say, man, what is this all about? Well, what it's about is that you're given the law. Here's how to live right, but when you don't do it, you're going to screw up, there has to be a sacrifice. There's no forgiveness without the shedding of blood. Now, interesting, we talked to Jews today. I've got a friend of mine who I work with, and he's Jewish, and he teaches in synagogue, and the day of Yom Kippur was coming up, and he was telling me about Yom Kippur. It's the Day of Atonement, and it's a big day for the Jews. It's the holiest day of the year. Now, Yom Kippur, if you read in the Old Testament, so my reference frame is the Bible. I've read about this in the Bible. I'm wondering, okay, well, what do you do today? Because Yom Kippur was the day of sacrifice. They sacrificed a scapegoat. There was a goat that was killed, and the blood was brought into the Holy of Holies. And I asked him about that. I said, you guys don't have, you know, you don't have a temple. You don't have a place to sacrifice the animals. And I was trying to ask him what they do. And he said, well, what we do is we ask forgiveness from God, and we ask forgiveness from others. He even asked me, have I sinned against you that I need to be forgiven for anything? I can't think of anything. And the Jews today, what they'll celebrate is, well, we'll overcome our bad deeds with our good deeds. And it sounds nice. It sounds really noble. They take a whole week of self-searching and think, okay, if I did anything wrong by God, I ask for forgiveness. And if I did anything wrong by others, I'll go to them and ask for forgiveness. And then if I've done something wrong, I'll try to make it up. It's a time of doing good deeds and reach out to us. It really sounds fantastic, doesn't it? Except there's one problem with it. It's not in the Bible. It is not God's word. And I asked him, you know, I'd heard that I've actually researched this. I know about this. I wanted to see if he knew about it, that there's people looking into rebuilding the temple and raising up the priests again and starting the sacrifices. It's all leading up to Revelation end times, if you know about that stuff. But I want to see if he knew anything about it. And he looked at me like, I don't know anything about that. And he looked at me a little bit sort of put off, like, all that stuff's disgusting. The sacrifices of the Old Testament. He didn't say that, but the blood sacrifices, and it sort of felt like, you know, we as Jews have gotten past that stuff. And that actually was somewhat the condition in the time of Paul, in the time of Christ. Yes, they had the sacrifices, but they missed the point of them. They had gotten to a legalism, to some extent, that was the money-making part of the business. That's why Jesus had to turn over the tables. But they had lost the point of forgiveness, of humbling. They tried to set their own standard of righteousness. And sometimes we can do it too. But all the way back in Deuteronomy, Paul quotes Moses, who says, don't think that what I'm putting before you is something that's too hard for you, as if you have to, he says in verse 6, who will ascend into heaven? Now, what he's talking about there is when you think, all right, well, how am I going to do this? Well, don't ask yourself, who will ascend into heaven, as in climb up the great heights, meditate my way into nirvana and get my way there. Who will ascend into heaven? And that's the idea of religion, isn't it? That's what you do. You kind of work your way up, or you meditate your way up. That's at the heart of the Buddhist theology. Is you keep working your way up by meditation. You lose yourself in the midst of meditating your way up. And it sounds really nice in a lot of ways. And the morality of Buddhism is pretty similar to the morality of Christianity, of doing right and wrong and treating people right. And there's a lot of things in common. Now, here's the thing. Do you know anybody who's gotten there? And if you talk to a Buddhist, they'll say, well, Buddha. Buddha got there. He got all the way up to the highest. And some of them actually respect Jesus. In some Buddhist understandings, that they'll say, well, just Buddha and the first Buddha and Jesus, they're the ones who've made it to the highest level, to made it to nirvana. They have a lot of respect, which is great. It's a great starting point for a conversation. Ask them what they think about Jesus. But here's the thing about that. You can ask yourself, who's going to make it all the way up there? We kind of look at it as like, yeah, I know that one guy, and he told me about that one other guy. We kind of look at it like one of these things. Anybody ever have one of these guys? For me, these were always, the Rubik's Cube was like, every once in a while, when you're a kid, these came out when I was a kid, so they were awesome. And has anybody out there actually know how to solve this thing? I used to know, and my dad can do it. Does anybody know somebody who says they know how to solve it? See, that's what it's like. That's what religion is like. It's like everybody knows somebody who once figured it out. I heard tell, right? And every once in a while you get some tips. Well, what you do is, and I heard some tips, you're supposed to match, it's the centerpiece that matches all the other one, right? So you have to get the, and figure out, it all starts with the centerpieces, and there's this method you can do it. And there was this kid who was in my youth group who used to go, you know, and I saw that, I remember I saw that TV show, there was a kid who could do it with his feet, and but the thing is, for most of us, religion is kind of like that. Oh, it seems possible. Every once in a while, I pick it up for a little while, and I tinker, and I get like 8 on one side, and I can't figure out how to get the last one in there. And then I find out that the guys who said they did it right, they just pried the corners off and put them back on. You know what I'm talking about? I look closely at first, you know, from a distance, like, look, I got the whole thing, and I look closely at it, like, you took the stickers off. They're all like peeling. And you just re-put them back on. You didn't figure it out. But for me, I always kind of felt like I'm working on this forever. And then finally, I look at the other side. And I've been missing a piece the whole time. I'm never going to get this thing. And that's what self-righteousness is like. It's like self-righteous, you know, you kind of put a facade on the outside. Jesus called them whitewashed tombs. You know, you whitewash the outside, put the stickers in the right places so you look like you got it all together. But inside, it's just, you're just dead man's bones. On the inside, you're just as mixed up and broken as the rest of us. You don't have your pieces together. You don't have it right. I know this one guy, there's that Buddha dude, and he got it all together, and Jesus got it all together. But most of us are pretty lost. I feel like there's a slideshow on my head. Okay, this is a complete aside, but when Amber was talking about this, you can turn it on. I don't actually mind. We were at worship once, and one of the guitar players walked into the words, and he had the word love like right there across his head. I was like, it's actually a really cool picture. I don't know what it has to do with the study. When it comes to being good enough, we ask, so well, what do I need to do to rise to the heavens? Do I need to meditate my way to the top? Or in verse 7, or who will descend into the deep? Maybe I need to think deeply. Maybe I need to dig into doctrines. Maybe I need to dig into prophecy in the Old Testament. When I really dig in, then I'll understand. Then I'll get it. This is not that complicated. You remember the story in the Old Testament of General Naaman? Remember in 2 Kings in chapter 5, General Naaman. There was a guy in the Old Testament. He was not a Jew. He was actually a general of, I think, of the king of Aram, if I remember right. And he's a great man, great conquest. And it says the Lord, interesting, he was not a Jew, he's not one of God's people, but it was the Lord who actually gave him victory in many cases. And because of that, he had attained to some level of greatness, but he caught leprosy. This great man who suddenly couldn't fix himself, who did all these great things. And when he caught leprosy, well, there was a servant in the court who says, you know what you should do? General Naaman should go talk to Elisha. There's a prophet in Israel, and he'll take care of it. He'll do it. The God of Israel can do it. So he hears about it. He says, all right, if that's what it takes. So he goes to Israel, to the prophet of Israel. He goes and visits Elisha. You remember what Elisha tells him to do? Elisha says to him, I'll read it to you. Elijah says to him, So Naaman went on his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to say to him, go wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you'll be cleansed. So he shows up with chariots and horses, and I mean, he shows up with a big parade. He's brought a whole bunch of gold and silver. He's like, I'll pay for this. I'll do whatever it takes. I'll pay anything to get rid of this leprosy. If he's got the cure, I want it. And Elisha doesn't even talk to the guy. The prophet of God doesn't even give him the time of day. He just, go send a servant. He finds out about it, either from revelation or somebody lets him know who's coming. He just sends a servant and tells him, just go dunk in the Jordan River 7 times and you're good. Now, why didn't he just say, believe in God? Well, he had to do something, a little sign of faith. And then it says in verse 11, but Naaman went away angry and said, I thought that he would say, surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord, his God. Wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than any of the waters of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them? So he walks off in a rage. He's like, he's going to cure me of leprosy by going dunking in some Israeli river in the Jordan? Why would I do that? We got bigger rivers back at home. I mean, he didn't even come out. I thought he was going to come out in a big show and declare the name of the Lord over me. Big show of power. And sometimes we want salvation to work like that. We want it to be some some big show where God comes down and shines his awesomeness on me. And I'm saved. You can't just like walk up to the front of the church and say a little prayer with some guy. He's not even the pastor. He made me go talk to some other bald guy. I can't get saved like that. So Naaman doesn't want to do it. He's going to go home leprous. He's going to go home dying. He'd rather die than humble himself and just go dunk in some water. But one of his servants speaks up. He says to him, Naaman's servants went to him and said, "My father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, wash and be cleansed?" So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. So his servant says to him, you realize if he had said to you, like, go eat a lion or go, I want you to travel the world and come back and bring me the jewels from the top of Everest, then you'd be like, yes, I am General Naaman and I shall do it. He just said, go dunk in some water. But it's humbling. It's humbling because it's not you. It's not how awesome you are. It's not what you worked for. It's just humbling. Now, he could have just said, just stand there and believe. But he had to take a step of faith. And so Naaman says, all right, you're right. I would have. So why not? And he dunks in the water and he's cleansed. But you know what happens to Naaman after that? He goes back to Elisha and he thanks him up and down. And he wants to offer him a whole bunch of money. He says, I brought all this silver and gold. And he brought him a bunch of sets of clothing, just clothing. Here's gifts. Here's nice clothing. Because he worked for the king. So the king gave him all this stuff. Yeah. Bring him all this stuff. You know what Elisha said? I won't take anything. You can't pay for salvation. You can't pay for healing. And Naaman even indicates he believes in God. He says, I'm going to serve God only now. He says, well, forgive me of this. I might have to like bow down when the king bows down, but just forgive me. I want to serve God and get it right. And he says, go in peace. You're okay. It's all right. But then guess what happens? After he goes on his way, pays nothing, brought all this money to pay for it, said, I would do anything. All he had to do was take this little step of faith that looks a lot like baptism, dunk in the water. He goes away clean, but then Elisha's servant, Gehazi goes out and he tracks him down. Gehazi's a little bummed. He's like, you didn't charge him anything. Did you see all the chariots he had? Did you see all the gold? He had a lot of stuff. So Gehazi goes out on his own and tracks down General Naaman and says, hey, it turns out Elisha kind of changed his mind just a little bit. Some people showed up and we need some clothes for him. We need a little silver. You know, we just need a, so maybe you could just get, and Naaman's like, all right. If that's what the prophet said, Elisha can have it. Here, take whatever you need. Gehazi goes back to Elisha, and Elisha says, where you been, man?
I didn't go anywhere. I didn't do anything. I've just been working away, you know, taking care of sheep or something.
And you know what? Do you remember? Anybody remember what happens to Gehazi? Elisha says, the leprosy that left Naaman will be upon you. Think about what happens in church when somebody tells someone, when we tell somebody, you can be forgiven, it's as easy as this. Just believe in your heart. Just declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. It's that simple. And they say, wow, and they're saved, and they're forgiven, and they walk off, and they're like, I'm clean. This is amazing. God forgave me. And then some other Christian comes along, another servant who says, well, you know, it costs a little bit more than that. I mean, it's still, you just got to do a few little works. You just got to put that little dollar of faith in the basket. Maybe a Benjamin, maybe a little bit more. You got to show your faith by just a little actions that happen to make me a little bit richer. And somebody overcomplicates it. Guess what happens to that somebody? That leprosy that was on the lost man is now put upon the one who overcomplicates God's forgiveness. When we turn it back and twist it into self-righteousness again, when we start to make it too difficult for our own personal gain, Christians can overcomplicate it. We can make it worse. So what does Paul say? He says, Do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the deep, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. That is the message concerning faith that we proclaim. The commentator Alfred said this. He says, let not the man who sighs for deliverance from his own sinfulness suppose that the accomplishment of some impossible task is required of him in order to enjoy the blessings of the gospel. No, our Christian message contains no impossibilities. We do not mock the sinner by offering him happiness on conditions which we know that he is powerless to fulfill. We tell him that Christ's word is near him, so near that he may speak it with his mouth and meditate on it with his heart. Salvation is near you. It really is that simple. Verse 9 says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Salvation is that simple. Get saved. Get right with God. And I got to say, it was on my heart this morning. I know there are people in this church who've been coming to church and and you like breakfast, and we got friendly people here. We got funny people here. You like this place. You don't feel out of sorts. You feel loved. But you haven't gotten right with God yet. You see, there's a step to take. There's a step to take. You're not right with God just because you walked into church. And I'm a Bible teacher. I'm not a gifted evangelist. I don't have magic. I'm not like Greg Laurie, where all I got to say is boo and suddenly everybody's crying and getting saved. But he says a little more than that. He says the gospel. And the gospel is this simple. It says right here, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. And some of you need to get right with God. Righteous. Hanging out here is not enough to get you right. We want to get you right. Why is it as simple as your mouth and your heart? Why does it come down to just your mouth and your heart? He says, just declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. Why are believing and professing so important to God? Well, one, because God doesn't like boasting. God doesn't want you to boast, to climb to the top of Mount Faith and say, I have climbed and conquered. He doesn't like boasting. Boasting's ugly. Boasting is looking down on others, and there'll be no boasting in heaven about who got themselves there. And second, works are good, but works can be selfish. If you work your way there, then it's about how I got there. And God wants selflessness. Works can be good for a little while, but they wear off. Faith and trust produce a lifetime of selfless work. See, it's a little bit like marriage, if you think about it. It's a little bit like marriage. And I enjoy talking about marriage because I got a couple here who I got to marry a few years ago. That's one of my favorite things I get to do. Taylor and Sam Ross, I love you guys. How's marriage going? See, now here's the amazing, fantastic thing about marriage. A man can ask, well, what do I need to do? What do I need to do to be married? I mean, we could put through, I'm the pastor, so I could like invent some rituals. And you got to climb, you gotta climb the face of this mountain. And you know, a man's like, I'm ready to do it. What does it take? What dragon do I need to slay? You know, what mountain do I need to climb? I would walk 500 miles and I would walk 500 more. Just to be the man who walked 1,000 miles to lay down at your door. But it doesn't work that way. You know how it works? You walk up and you use words. Use words. You say, well, words are empty. No. Words can be empty, but when you walk up to here, this place is an altar. You got to write, well, every time when I marry a couple, I got to warn you guys too. When you walk up to, Dan's engaged, by the way. And Dan and Reagan are still engaged. And when every engaged couple, when they talk about marriage, they say, you got to recognize when you walk to the front of the church, the place you get married is not, you don't go to a playground to get married. You don't go to the store to buy it. You don't go to the amusement park to enjoy it. You go to the altar. You know what happens at altars? You know what altar, I mean, we call the front of the church an altar, but you recognize what an altar is. It's a place where you kill things. It's where animals go to die. Amen. The, And when you walk up there, it's not some great feat you have to perform. There's no like pull-up bar, as much as Taylor would have been awesome if I had given a pull-up bar. Young Marine walks up. No, you just have words. I gave you two words to say. I will. I will. You proclaim with your mouth, I will. The convictions of your heart. You see, your mouth is a powerful tool. The Bible tells you, how warns you about how powerful the dangers of your mouth, but it's also a powerful tool. You proclaim the convictions of your heart and say, this is who I am, this is what I believe. You proclaim, Jesus is Lord. When you get saved, it is a proclamation of lordship over your life. When you get married, you say, I will. I will have and hold, rich or poor, better or worse. I will love you. I will cherish you. You better remember that was important. But it is a proclamation of who you are from now on. It is a laying down of the life before and saying, this is the life I am ahead. It's a proclamation that affects all the works for the rest of your life. You don't work for it. Marriage doesn't work that way. A man could say, well, I already did all this stuff for her. I slayed the dragon. I walked 1,000 miles. I did all of it. You're still not married until you say the words. It is the words of proclaiming, this is me for the rest of my life. Salvation works the same way. You don't have to slay the beast. Jesus already paid the price. He gave his life. But you say the words, Jesus is Lord. And the word Lord there is a big one. It's the word of kingship. When you come to God, you proclaim who is the king of your life, of your heart, of your soul. The word Lord is the Greek word kurios. In the Greek Old Testament, the word Lord was used for God. They switched out. You know how in the Old Testament we see Lord, capital L-O-R-D? It was the word God, the Y-H-W-H, the name of God was switched out for Lord. So when Paul said Lord, every Jew would know what he's talking about. And every Gentile would know the word Lord was used for the Caesar, the one that they all hailed as the God-man, the king. But when you come to Jesus, there's one Lord. You proclaim Jesus as Lord and say he's in charge of my life. And you believe in your heart. Why do you say believe in your heart? That's kind of a funny thing, because don't you believe with your mind? Well, yeah, you believe in your mind, but minds change, don't they? Minds are easy to change. Hearts, not so much. Hearts set themselves on a path. And when you set that path, just as a man coming to the altar to get married sets himself, my heart is devoted to just one now, romantically speaking. When you come up to the altar to give your life to the Lord, your heart is devoted to one. You believe in your heart. See, belief in the mind is, intellectually, I think that's true. And I think that's part of it. But when you get to belief of the heart, it's conviction and it's devotion. He doesn't say feel in your heart. Yeah, I kind of feel like Jesus is the real deal. I kind of feel like that. No, he says, believe in your heart. He mixes the intellect with the emotion and brings them together and says, believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. What he's saying is you believe in a living Lord. I'm not just believing in some old fairy tale or some old story. You believe that Jesus is alive. And he's your Lord today. And he says, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. That means made right with God. And it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and you're saved. That means rescued from every trouble. You don't have to climb your way out of it. You don't have to dig a tunnel to escape from the prison you put yourself in. You just stand up right in your cell right now and profess Jesus is Lord. Believe in your heart, God raised him from the dead. And you're saved. You're forgiven. As scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, you got to use your mouth. If you can't speak, sign language works. It works in every language. But you got to say Jesus is Lord. And if you do, you'll never be put to shame. Isn't that a beautiful promise? Shame is that awful feeling that you got to hide something, that you got to move the stickers around so it looks like you got your Rubik's Cube all together. That's that feeling that you're not good enough, that you just can't. You'll never be good enough. But you put your faith in Jesus, says there's no shame. You will never be put to shame. All the things you are ashamed of, he casts as far as the east is from the west. casts them to the very depths of the sea, and he never brings them up again. So we're done with the Bible study, but if you are in that place where you need that salvation, you need that rescue, I won't overcomplicate it. It's a simple profession with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, Lord of your life. You come to the altar. You don't have to like get on your knees and crawl or beg. It's just simple humility. You say, I got to do something. I got to clean myself up. I got to get myself right. Well, go ahead, General Naaman. You know, do some great mighty deed. It's not going to work because it's not God's righteousness. It's your self-righteousness. You do it that way, you'll just look down on everybody. If you just need to get right with God, you've been coming in here, then get right with God today. God gave you one simple way. Profess Jesus is the Lord. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for truth. Lord, today, move in our hearts. Lord, many of us here have made a proclamation, Jesus is Lord. Help us to live it out with every step, with everything we do. Lord, we believed in our hearts, and we know the conviction of the truth. Lord, though our minds may change and waver at times, Lord, the conviction of our hearts, we believe that Jesus died for our sins on a cross, that he conquered death that day, that you raised him from the dead, and that he reigns forever with you. That we don't need to climb, that we don't need to descend, that Jesus already did the work. He came down to heaven to meet us right where we are. He went down into the depths of the earth. He died and was buried, but you rose him again to give us new life. Lord, I pray that today would be the day that you give new life to the lost, that they believe your simple gospel and put their trust in you. If there's anybody here who would like to be saved, very simply saved, rescued, forgiven, you don't have to do any great and mighty deed, but just proclaim with me and say this prayer after me. Jesus, you are Lord. You are the Savior of my life. Please forgive me of my sins. Please give me hope again. Please give me a new life. I give mine to you. I confess every sin. And most of all, I confess that you are Lord. You're in charge of my life now. Forgive me and guide me. And when I die, take me home. Jesus, in your name I pray. Amen. Let's all stand up together. Let's sing.